Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome. Today, this evening, we will hear from Naomi Shandel Seidman, the Caret Professor of Jewish Culture at the Graduate Theological Union. She is also the NEH Senior Scholar at the Center for Jewish History right now, and she is on leave this year, happily working with the benefit of a Guggenheim. So we're excited. I mean, I'm excited, and I think you all should be also, that she's taking time off from her time on leave to come talk with us. Naomi is, I think, one of the most exciting, provocative, inspirational scholars working in Yiddish and in Jewish cultures, Jewish literatures today. She's written a bunch of books that I make my graduate students read, so anyone here who's been in my graduate classes knows them. For instance, her first book, Marriage Made in Heaven, The Sexual Politics of Hebrew and Yiddish. Another book of hers, Faithful Renderings, Jewish-Christian Difference and the Politics of Translation. She has a forthcoming book about Beis Yaakov, the girls' schools, and she's now working on a book about Freud and Yiddish. But what she'll talk about today is not any of those books, but a different book, the one that just came out, The Marriage Plot, or How Jews Fell in Love with Love, comma, and with Literature. So this is a very fun and provocative and thought-inspiring book that I had the pleasure of reading a few months ago. It talks about Jews and love and marriage, as advertised. It covers 200 years of literary history, and it makes a sort of thrilling, big, new argument about how Western and Christian ideas about romance relate to what it means to be Jewish and what it's meant to be Jewish in what I guess we can call the modern period. So I'm gonna get out of the way so we can hear from Naomi. Let us welcome her.
Thank you so much for coming. It's so heroic that you, I don't know, swam here or came in boats or, and thank you so much for the introduction and also to Charlotte for the invitation and to Verit. I think you were part of it also. And I also want to thank everybody at Stanford for the existence of this book, because the book actually began with a lecture I gave at Stanford, I think it was in 2010. The Clara Sumpf lecture, and I gave a talk called The Sexual Transformation of Ashkenaz, and that was the first little bit of this book. So, and here I am, so it's a nice circle to be drawing. And the book is also published by Stanford University Press, so it has Stanford stamped all over it. So I'm very glad to be here. I should say that what I'm talking about is the sexual transformation of Eastern European Jews, so their modernization as the transformation of marriage practices and gender roles and sexual structures. But this is a process, the movement from arranged marriage or other forms of traditional marriage to modern romance, which is very widespread. There are many cultures that are going through this transformation now, or that have gone through it in the past. So what I'm talking about is both narrow and, I think, a more general story about modernity. I think I'll start and end by reading small sections of the book, not too much, a page or a page and a half. But for most of my talk, I'll give a PowerPoint presentation, and I'll also show a little bit of Fiddler on the Roof, which is the most famous literary expression of the transformation that I'm talking about. And it's also very handy to talk about because it's the one Jewish text that I think we can count on for people to know. It used to be the Bible, but now it's Fiddler on the Roof. Is there somebody here who doesn't know Fiddler on the Roof? I'm just curious. It really is. And is there someone here who will admit to not knowing the Bible? I thought we could. Okay. So this is the first page of my book. And I'll just read for a page. Don't worry too much. Eastern European Jews seem to have fallen in love with love. Oh, maybe I'll turn to this. Very complicated, turning to the next slide and reading at the same time. But I think I could do it. Eastern European Jews seem to have fallen in love with love, not gradually, but suddenly, virtually overnight. The moment, fortunately for us, was captured by a few acute observers. For Pauline Vengeroff, the dramatic and traumatic transformation between traditional marriage and modern love came between her sister Eva's 1848 engagement and her own engagement in 1849. I was 15 years old when my sister, who was 2 years older than I, was betrothed. Yes, she was betrothed, and not, as girls today call it, got engaged herself. Our parents and those of the bridegroom dealt with each other through the marriage broker, the Schadchan, and agreed how much dowry, clothing, and jewelry from both sides of the marriage parties was to be given. My sister did not see the face of her bridegroom, her life's companion, at all. And she was not able to satisfy herself about whether she would be able to love him and whether he suited her fancy and met the ideals that a girl privately formed about her intended. Alive to the subtle as well as the broadest workings of modernization, Vengeroff makes a fine distinction in this description between her sister becoming engaged and her sister and bridegroom getting engaged, different ways of putting it in German. For all the similarity between these German phrases, they express a world of difference. In the first instance, the bride is the passive object of a betrothal arranged for her by others. In the second, the young people are the active agents of mutual betrothal. Indeed, Eva's engagement was entirely the doing of her parents and the groom's parents. Despite her tearful attempts to persuade her mother to allow her to meet the young man in question, Eva was not permitted to lay eyes on him until the very hour of the wedding. Eva was nervous and unhappy in the weeks before her wedding, but Vengeroff assures us that most such marriages contracted in the old way turned out well, and such a marriage my sister also was allotted by dear God. Vengeroff ends her detailed description of Eva's wedding by looking ahead to her own very different experience. Only this sister was still engaged and married in the manner described here. My engagement, 2 years later, already had a different character. Indeed, the reform under the regime of Nicholas I had powerfully affected the Jewish way of life. In comparison with her older sister, in 1849, the 16-year-old Pauline was permitted to meet the young man her parents had chosen for her, and Vengeroff implies that the betrothal was contingent on the young people finding each other appealing. After initial discussions with the marriage broker, the two extended families met in a town midway between their homes to become acquainted and hammer out the terms of the betrothal. While the older people negotiated the financial arrangements, little by little, the younger people withdrew to the neighboring room. My intended followed also, and finally, my sister Kathy invited me to follow the others. Here, etiquette was set aside. We sat down freely next to one another, I, of course, near my bridegroom. Scarcely had we sat for a moment near one another when the room emptied. Everyone left in order to leave the two of us undisturbed. This behavior irritated me so much that I was unable to utter a word and kept silent, embarrassed. But then my intended began to speak. Trembling from emotion, he spoke to me of his feelings, his love, loyalty, undying happiness. Far more than his words, his eyes spoke. Vengeroff's memories of the dramatic events of 1848 and 1849, the moment, it could be said, when Jews fell in love with love, can serve to introduce the two intertwined themes of this book, the secularization and modernization of Jewish marriage, and the role of literature in that transformation. I skipped a paragraph where she talked about, in that same chapter, how suddenly everybody became crazy for literature, which she saw as part of the same process of people falling in love with love. In the 2 years that separated the engagements of sisters, the marriage practices in one Russian Jewish family were significantly and fatefully transformed, with the waves of modernization that washed over traditional Jewish societies. Such experiences and their variants were repeated throughout Jewish Eastern Europe. The pedagogical workings of literature may explain the ability of a young man, at first meeting his irritated and speechless prospective bride, to find ready poetic expression for his hopes regarding love, loyalty, undying happiness to the young woman before him. And something like an invisible cultural hand seems to have guided their young friends and relatives to orchestrate a separate gathering away from their elders, and then the gradual withdrawal from the space that provided the young couple with some time alone. Vengerov suggests that, unlike the more formal seating and conversational arrangements that accompanied the parents' negotiations in the other room, here, in this room, etiquette was set aside, and it seemed entirely natural for the prospective bride and groom to find themselves seated side by side. Surely, however, there was another etiquette at play in this wordless collective choreography. Although Vengerov remembers experiencing it as the carefully calibrated loosening of the restrictions that had kept her sister from setting eyes on her groom before the wedding, what she describes is also a culture in formation in which it is understood that romantic conversation is conducted in private, precisely what tradition forbids an unmarried man and woman. That these conventions were still new and untested may account for the ritual misfire in which Pauline seems to have experienced her solitude with her young fiancé, not as romantic opportunity, but rather as manipulation by her sisters and friends, if I understand her irritation correctly. This propagation of these new cultural practices in such a short period no doubt required multiple agents and derived from a variety of sources, but Vengerov's intuition that they were tightly connected with emerging reading practices is the path I travel in this book. So the project is to discover the role that literature played in the transformation of Jewish practices from arranged marriage to traditional, to the love match. And in this way, I didn't have to forge new ground entirely. I borrowed a lot from a scholar named Ian Watt, who I believe taught at Stanford, didn't he? He taught here in the 19th, very handsome dude, may I say. He taught here in the 50s and 60s, and at least for a while, he was a leading scholar of English literature of the 18th century. And I think his work is not read so much anymore. Could you tell me that, whether that's the case?
Maybe not as much as it should be.
Not as much as it should be. I think he basically got lost in the move to post-structuralism and deconstruction, etc. But he was a very interesting scholar and who wrote a book called The Rise of the Novel, in which he made an argument about the novel, summarizing this sentence, "The most universal religion of the West is the sex religion. Love between the sexes is to be regarded as the supreme value of life on earth. The novel supplies it with its doctrine and its rituals, just as the medieval romance had done for courtly love." And to summarize his argument a little bit more fully, so he looked at the 18th century novel, and he argued that the novel emerged from and ideologically supported a range of new conditions in 18th century England, including such philosophical new ideas that were becoming newly widespread as the independent, autonomous individual, the economic conditions such as the rise of a middle class, a commercial middle class, urbanization, a new division of labor, and a new marital distribution of labor in which it was understood that women of a middle class would stay home and not work, and a new, the new, basically the new importance of marriage for women. Because women were now living typically far away from their parents, they newly needed to get married more. They needed to get married. They were living away from their parents. They needed to find a place to live for economic reasons. So marriage was newly important for women and less so for men. And there was a kind of crisis of basically a need to persuade men of the importance of marriage. And I remembered what that last thing I was looking for was, which is new leisure time for women to read novels. So all of these conditions conspired to produce the modern novel. And the modern novel did a number of things. It provided women who were no longer servants or working in the field something to fill their leisure with. And it also provided the kind of ideological argument for why it is for the marital distribution of labor, which is the distinction between men and women, their complementarity. So men and women were not identical. Women were dramatically different from men. Men were more sexual. Women were more spiritual. These are among the ways in which, these are among the gender ideologies that were propagated by the modern novel. The importance of romance for all concerned was a way of, on some level, covering over the difficult and painful economic importance of marriage for women. So now women, the idea that women played hard to get was a way of flattering them and covering over the difficulty of marriage and the importance of marriage by insisting that it's something that men need and want from women. So it was an orchestrated attempt on some level to cover over the material conditions of marriage so that you didn't talk about wanting to marry somebody because you needed a place to live and food to eat, but marriage was all about sublime meaning of soulmates, but nevertheless it managed to express, even as it obscured, the material conditions, the new material conditions in the 18th century that made marriage both so difficult and so crucial for women, by a kind of flattering romantic ideology of the beauty of romance and of women. So marriage, how did marriage work? The novel worked to kind of inculcate the distinctions between men and women, to talk about how it is that you go about courtship in now that parents are no longer involved. And even the length of a novel, the pacing of a novel, even the focus on the young people as opposed to the older people who might have been involved in traditional marriage were ways of demonstrating and supporting and reinforcing the importance of new models of marriage, of romantic love, of the love match. This is Watts' basic argument in The Rise of the Novel. And what's interesting to me in particular when I read this novel is how it might work in the Jewish world, in which there are many things that are similar. The move from arranged marriage to modern romance is also very similar. The role of the parents and the expulsion of the parents from the modern love match are very similar. But there are some things that are very distinct about the 18th century English example that Ian Watt brings up, including his argument that it all derives from, he basically creates a lineage for the modern novel, which is that it begins with Mariolatry, the worship of the Virgin Mary, which then in the Middle Ages gets transformed in the chivalric romance, in which there continues to be a worship of an unattainable woman. And in the 18th century novel, this English novel, this unattainable beautiful woman who was only the great lady in the medieval romance is now every woman. Every woman gets to play the role of the woman that is looked up to. It gets sort of democratized and becomes available for all, at least middle class women. In trying to apply this to the Jewish novel, the first problem we can see is that Jews lack that prehistory. There's no prehistory of the Jewish worship of either a virgin or of any woman for that matter. Virginity has none of that religious character. So if it's the case, which it is for Watt, that the novel took religious impulses and secularized them, it would have to work differently, you can already see, in the Jewish case. And part of what I did in this book is to try to figure out, well, what happened in the Jewish case if Jews lacked this religious prehistory that contributed to the form of the modern novel. Okay, so one of the things that I think really is very important to the Jewish novel, and one of the things that it does share with Watt's argument, is nuclearization. That the Jewish family also did what sociologists call nuclearization. That in modern marriage, the couple immediately sets up as a new family, wholly separate from their own parents and often far away from them. Extended kinship ties lose their significance, and the conjugal family typically becomes an autonomous unit. So this is a, let's say, a kind of side effect of the modern love match. The modern love match is seen as being only about the young people. And if the older people appear in a modern novel, they're only there basically to do the work of giving the young people a hard time. They're the kind of obstacles that are necessary to turn a love story from a short story, a boy meets girl and they lived happily ever after, into a 200-page novel. So they perform the function of delaying the marriage and creating obstacles and just being annoyingly old and being uninterested in having these people get together because they're not, you know, think of Romeo and Juliet as a kind of exemplary case. The parents are there to be the opposite of what you need. So the idea that the extended family is the price that is paid for the modern romance is something that the novel will not acknowledge. In the terms that the modern novel lays out, the typical plots of the modern novel, parents are the problems that the ways in which the parents are left out of the deliberations are necessary for the modern novel to continue. That what's lost is extended family is something that the novel will not generally acknowledge, certainly not in its earliest stages. That there is something to this extended family. Did you have a question? I wanted to say that you're looking like maybe you have a question. I'm speaking, but please, if you have a complaint or a question, now just say that this is another case. Although this is the marriage that the marriage creates extended family relies upon marriage. At least some historians of marriage say that extended family is the most important aspect of marriage. That actually, what marriage does, most importantly, is to create families beyond the smaller family. And this is particularly important to, for instance, nomadic tribes, in which if you're going to be wandering around large areas, then it's really important to have relations everywhere you go. Obviously, Jews are nomadic tribes, and as a matter of fact, like other, let's say, mobile societies, Jews have particularly strong or ramified notions of extended family. And evidence for this is, sociological evidence for this is actually linguistic, that there are, in Yiddish, there are words for father-in-law, mother-in-law, son-in-law, sister-in-law, whatever, that Yiddish shares with the coextensive populations, so with German. And then there are words, it turns out that German doesn't have enough words for extended family, so you need to borrow it from Hebrew. So it's also the case, I think, let's say a more available example is from English, which is that the term Machatanim is the example that I always use. What does machatanim mean? Who said that? In-laws in a particular sense. In what particular sense is when I say my machatenista, who am I referring to? Exactly. In other words, in English, when you say in-laws, it usually means the diagonal one. It usually means your husband's parents, let's say, or your daughter's husband, right? In Yiddish, it mostly means the parents of your child's spouse. And this is an actual kinship term. This is an immediately available kinship term that English more or less lacks. And this is, in other words, by what I mean by an available kinship term, it means a term that signifies obligation. It doesn't mean you like these people. Lord knows not. It means that you have a mutual kinship obligations with this set of people. And these are people that are your family. In other words, when you need something, you can go to them. You might not want to invite them for your Seder, but when you need them, they have to be there for you. That's at least, in principle, those are the kinship obligations. So this is one of the, as I said, the less visible aspects of what the move from arranged marriage to modern romance entails. Because the move from to modern romance focuses so with such laser-sharp focus on the excitingness of love, of young love, on the, you know, the hormones of that experience, that what it expels from or what it marginalizes is less obvious. But this is one of the things that that Ian Watt talks about that I think is particularly relevant to the Jewish case. So the Jewish case, the first Hebrew novel, Ahavat Zion by Avraham Mapu, which came out in 1853, I believe is the same year as Madame Bovary, which Robert Alter has a line that says, comparing the two is like comparing Paradise Lost to Joyce Kilmer, The Trees. So this is not a great novel. I'm not necessarily recommending it. But it is an example of the amazing power that the novel had on traditional Jewish society, the ways in which it dramatically transformed life. I mean, when it came out, it came out, first of all, it went through many, many, many editions. And we have many, many autobiographies that talk about the first reading of Ahavat Zion. I list all the autobiographies and the impression that it made. We have, I'll give you just a few, quite a few people talk about how it was in their knapsack when they ran away from home, which I believe now it's Zen and the Art of, at least when I was the age to run away from home, was Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance. It was basically the novel you run away from home with. For all the people who ran away from home. It's the novel that persuades you that you too want to write a novel. It's the novel, so Shalom Aleichem read it and decided he was going to write a novel, more or less the same novel he decided he was going to write. He basically read it straight through in a weekend and had just had the worst headache. And it excited the Jewish world. And I think you have to understand, actually a really good example is there was a young memoirist who talked about being engaged to be married when he read it, which is a dangerous time to read this love story, and he realized that he did not want to marry his not very appealing, not very attractive bride, and he says, why couldn't, he was marrying the daughter of his, the head of his yeshiva. You know, the best boy gets to marry the daughter of the, my brother married the daughter of the head of the yeshiva. He says, the head of the yeshiva was a very handsome man. Why he couldn't have, like, taken care to have also had a beautiful daughter. So the idea that all of a sudden you wanted to marry someone beautiful is one of the effects of this novel. That you're not just happy to be, you know, having been awarded the prize of marrying, of being related to the head of your yeshiva. Now you also want a beautiful bride. Among the effects of this novel is a, one of the ways it made such an impact is that it was a love story set at the time of the prophet Isaiah. So it's told in biblical Hebrew. You have to be of, which is, you know, Hebrew was not a spoken language at this time. So basically the readership of this was only men, really, which is also another interesting thing. But men, young boys, excellent students, basically on the verge of going bad. This is not something that your teacher is telling you to read. This is something you're reading in secret. So this is a novel that basically tells you that you that in the past of the Jewish people, there was true romance. There were people like Amnon and Tamar, the heroes of this novel. Amnon is it's a very complicated novel, a novel of intrigue. It's really difficult to keep the characters straight. And Amnon is a shepherd who's actually a high-born prince, but he had to be sort of whisked away because he was about to be, you know, one of those stories. So he was raised as a shepherd, and he thinks he's a shepherd, but he's actually a prince. And Tamar is a princess or a high-born young woman from a rich family. And the twist of the novel is that despite the fact that there's a real class difference between Amnon and Tamar, she's very rich and he's just a shepherd. In fact, he's actually not only himself from her family circle and also very rich, but actually had been promised to, by their, the both fathers had promised these children to each other before they were born because they were best friends. But then all kinds of things went bad and complicated villains, so that they were raised apart from each other, and they didn't know that they had actually been promised to each other. So one of the arguments that I make is that this particular plot twist, which is everywhere in Jewish literature, so it's also the same plot twist if you've read or seen the D-book, which I know you have, Anski's very, very popular play. It has exactly the same plot twist. So as a term, which is that despite the fact that you have this couple, that as is standard and normative in all romantic literature, their parents do not allow them to talk to each other. They may not marry each other, right? Otherwise, what's the fun of falling in love with each other? So they're forbidden to be with each other. So in that sense, they're like Romeo and Juliet. But nevertheless, because of an incredibly, ridiculously complicated plot, they're actually supposed to be married together. They're God himself wants them to be married to each other. So this seems to be a twist that right from the very start, Jewish literature is in love with. So basically my argument is that right from the very start, the modern Jewish novel, modern Jewish romance, develops these kinds of hybrid formations in which it has it both ways. You have the forbidden romance. You get to be with the boy your parents will not let you talk to. At the same time, it turns out that you're basically expressing, not only expressing in some normative sociological way, but in some mystical way, the demands of the tradition, that you marry someone that your parents wanted you to marry, that you're fulfilling this idea of Jewish fate, which is that God himself, you know, the very famous Midrash, what has God been doing all these years since creation, which actually wasn't that long ago, by the way, 5,700 and something. He's making matches. He's sitting around going, okay, this one and this one. So this is, at least in some of its formations, this mystical Jewish idea that who you're meant to marry is something that has been foreordained. And in these novels, this notion is somehow combined with the notion of traditional arranged marriage to rescue arranged marriage through the modern novel, which is designed to do everything to put an end to the modern novel. So the modern novel expresses this kind of nostalgia for some of the traditional elements of Jewish life. And to sort of make my argument explicit, and then to do a reading of some of the more specific ways in which it works out, that basically what Jewish literature does is produce a hybrid form of the modern novel as read through traditional culture, traditional Jewish culture, that despite the fact that people loved Mapu's novel, among the other ways, I just remember that they would walk around the woods. All of a sudden, they were discovering the woods, discovering the modern romance, and discovering the woods as part of the same cultural moment. They would walk around trying to speak Hebrew to each other, and the men would call the women Tamar, and the women would call the men Amnon, and they would name their children Amnon and Tamar. So that, and you know that, despite this complete embrace of romance, sincere falling in love with love, they did it differently, and they produced a kind of odd hybridity in which they insisted on maintaining the significance of the modern of traditional marriage. Even sociologically, they produced hybrid forms so that matchmaking went underground. Parents would basically arrange matches, but they would somehow arrange for young men and women to just be in the same place at the same time. So that these were culturally and literarily hybrid forms. And Jews never completely swallowed certain aspects of the sex religion. They never swallowed, for instance, the idea that men and women were so dramatically different, and that women were these pure creatures, pure, beautiful creatures. They never believed entirely in this. The most important love that there is the love between a young man and a young woman. They suspected often that the love between parents and children was at least as powerful and was at least as strong. And the argument is that this, basically what Jews produced is a kind of heretical version of the modern sex religion, which in the 20th century became, through Freud, through Lenny Bruce, through Erika Jong, through Fiddler on the Roof, became actually the dominant mode of thinking about sex and love in the modern world. That's my biggest argument. So let me talk a little bit about, I'll go back to the PowerPoint and try to remember how it all linked up with what I was just telling you. Well, what the argument that I wanted to make with this image, this comes from the Bible, Fiddler on the Roof, and basically this moment in which Fiedka Chava in the book, where he's telling her, his first approach, the non-Jew, who, right, the Gentile, the Cossack, who courts this beautiful young Jewish woman, Tevye's daughter, does it through a book. Go ahead, take the book, and after you return it, we can talk about it for a while, and then we can talk about life, how we feel about things. Sometimes this is described as an intermarriage, and it's true that Chava, this is Chava, the daughter that converted to Russian Orthodoxy, Chava converted to Russian Orthodoxy. I think another way of describing it is that both the Russian Orthodox man and the Jewish woman converted to the sex religion, and they read the novel that was its guide and manual. And according to this, the novel, which is its guide and manual, your religion and your parents are of no importance at all, and certainly of very little importance compared to this huge thing, which is falling in love. The role that Chava plays, I think, in the Tevye story and in Fiddler on the Roof, is to begin to put, both to manifest what the sex religion is, its subscription to the notion that you choose your own mate And that's the most important experience you'll have. And it, sorry to use this word, it trumps all others. And also, because we see this through Chava's father's eyes, the beginning of a suspicion that maybe that's not entirely true. Maybe there's something else, or at least maybe there's this all-important thing came at a cost, if not to Chava, then to Tevye. So that's the crucial role that I think this plays here. These are my slides that talk about the significance of traditional marriage. This is actually my book. Did you see it just got reviewed in the Jewish Review of Press, a Jewish Review of Books, and somehow they found this postcard to illustrate the book, which I didn't have in my own book, and I was very interested to see. And I love the postcard so much. This is a postcard that describes this ritual. So one of the things I tried to say in that first page that I read is that modern courtship is very ritualistic, despite the fact that it manifests itself as the rejection of ritual. We will be free. But so is traditional courtship. It's also very ritualistic in certain ways. And this is a ritual of traditional marriage. Before, one of the rituals of traditional marriage is examining or men verhert dem chosen, verhering. It means giving the groom a test in order to decide whether you can marry, usually the daughter, a rich man's daughter. And the rich man is going to support this boy for a few years while he sits and learns. He wants to know if he's going to support an A student or a B student. So that actually might be the rich merchant who's listening to a rabbi or a teacher examining the groom. But the reason why this is, I think, funny is that there are two examinations going on at the same time. There's the explicit ideology of traditional marriage, which is that there is a purely male space in which a father-in-law and a rabbi and a matchmaker and a teacher are all paying close attention to a 13, 14, 15-year-old boy to see how smart he is, because that's the major qualification, along with a decent pedigree, for getting a rich man to marry you to his daughter. At the same time, that's the explicit ideology. There may also be a lot of other things that are going on, which is that the women are also watching, and what they're saying is probably, is he cute or not? You know, they don't have any interest in, I mean, hope, you know, great, he really knows the Talmud. They're all looking at him to see, oh, nice skin, he is rather, I think, a kind of handsome boy. What's interesting in the modern romance is that there's a similar explicit dimension and implicit dimension. In other words, there's what's going on the surface, and then there's what's going on underneath. In the modern sex religion, it may only be about pure romantic love. And if it so happens to be the case that the person, let's see whether I have this next, if it so happens to be the case that the person that you want to marry, that, in other words, all marriages may only be about mutual sexual attraction and the meeting of souls. If it happens to be the case that you're a poor Eastern European girl with nothing to show for yourself but really good legs, then the secret dimension of the marriage may not be spoken, but it's obvious. In other words, what remains the explicit dimension is it has to be about love and romance. And if there are any practical considerations, then you aren't supposed to talk about them. It's exactly the opposite in traditional marriage. You spend all your time with the other family talking about money, who's going to support the young couple. And if there happens to be sexual attraction, let's not talk about it. It's just not a nice thing to talk about. So there's a way in which the modern romance and the traditional match are not that different. The only difference is what you talk about and what you don't. So in this case, what I wanted to talk about with this slide is this is the scene. Do you remember who Huddle is and Perchik? Huddle is Tevye's second daughter who marries the communist. Now Tevye's in the case of this is one of those examples of a romance, right? She marries Tevye. She marries Perchik. She does not tell Tevye that she's interested in him. He says at one point, "Did I really, you're engaged? When were the negotiations? Why was I not informed?" In other words, he's presenting himself as somebody who was not available to be part of the contraction of this marriage. As a matter of fact, how did Huddle meet Perchik? She met Perchik because Tevye brought him into the house. He bumped into him on the road, and he brought him home. Not only did he bring him home, but if you remember, they had a long conversation with each other on the cart, in which Tevye is trying to do exactly what a traditional father with marriageable daughters, which Lord knows he has, tries to do, which is, where are you from? Who are your parents? And what does Perchik say? He says, "I'm nobody. I'm God's child." He's not playing the game, or he's pretending not to play the game. But the truth is, in the same way that all these traditional fathers-in-law discovered their sons-in-law by basically figuring out who the best boy in the yeshiva was, or in the case of the Baal Shem Tov, the founder of Hasidism, it says overtly, his father-in-law fell in love with the Baal Shem Tov and said, "Are you single? Come marry my daughter-in-law." This was a standard traditional way for fathers to find husbands for their sons. So despite the fact that this seems like a most romantic love match between a communist and a very, spirited and rebellious young daughter, beneath the surface, Tevye is basically the matchmaker who made this match happen. And his surprise when they get engaged is actually, I think, a little bit hard to swallow. He's playing the game as much as they are. So the Shalom Aleichem is an interesting case to study this transition from. I mean, not only because he's so well known, but because he himself, in his first novel, went from basically writing, his first novel, Stempenu, is basically a standard by the book, let's get the parents out of the love match novel. Not only that, it's a plot point hinges on the married young couple moving out of the home of the parents, where, as is traditional, that a young couple lives with usually the parents of the bride, but sometimes the parents of the groom. In this case, they're in the parents of the groom. So in his first novel, he wrote a totally traditional novel that champions young love and nuclearization and rejects the input of older people into marriage, the contraction of a marriage. It might be relevant to Shalom Aleichem's case that he himself eloped with his 16-year-old student. He was a tutor in her house. But people get older. He had daughters himself. And maybe the attractions of traditional marriage began to reveal themselves to him, because in his later work, including most famously, Tevye the Dairyman, he managed to figure out all kinds of ways to rescue traditional marriage from the modern, from the sex religion. And for those people who say, I think that Fiddler on the Roof has been misread as a story about the move from traditional marriage to modern romance. It's actually, and there were plenty of novels that were like that. The reason it's so popular, I think, is because it's about the opposite thing. It's about the persistence of traditional marriage and the nostalgia for traditional marriage within modern romance. Let's talk about the first marriage. So the first marriage, as you remember, is Zeitl, and the matchmaker, we have the Jenta in the film, is a total invention of the film. She tries to marry off Zeitl to, do you remember who? Laser Wolf the Butcher, who's rich but a butcher. And he's a widow, and he's old. And she wants to marry Muttel, the tailor Muttel Kamsoil, who's poor. But, you know, they have a connection. So this is understood as Laser Wolf is the traditional groom. And it's traditional, we know, because there is a matchmaker. As a matter of fact, there isn't a matchmaker in the original Yiddish stories. And the reason why there isn't a matchmaker is because this isn't a traditional marriage. This is a modern marriage. It's only in a traditional marriage, the beautiful person. So in a traditional marriage, the main focus is on the beautiful, brilliant young boy. The idea that a beautiful, forget brilliant, young girl could marry up is a feature of the sex religion. The traditional marriage is prototypically the marriage between a rich man who has no sons, who basically buys himself a Torah scholar. You know what? Maybe we'll go to the... Oh, we're back. Can we go to the clip? So I'm just going to end with showing you a little piece of Fiddler on the Roof. And it's a sing-along if you want. I'm sure you all know it. The Taylor Muttel comes oil. And then I'll end by giving you a little taste of my reading of this. In bringing back the dead, Tevye undercuts at least one of the major tenets of the sex religion, which disdains the relevance of ancestral recommendations in the choice of a mate. It seems significant that Tevye's dream is the invention of a clever husband and the writer who dreams him up, rather than an authentic communication from the past, even if the story leaves open the question of whether the genealogical narrative it transmits is also fictional. Tevye brings back the memory of an extended family network that includes his future son-in-law, not in the context of the normal family arrangements in which they would certainly have been unearthed, but only as a feature of the buried and forgotten past. In the dream, which is also a tale, a long-dead great-grandmother plays the role of family genealogist and even, in some sense, retroactive matchmaker. She gives her seal of approval to the match that unites her great-granddaughter with a member of their circle, an ordinary traditional attitude rendered remarkable only for having been unburied after being lost to memory. Tevye's dream, invented and staged for an audience of one, has reached many millions more in the stage and film versions of Shalom Aleichem's stories. Finding the lost connections between his daughter and her bridegroom, Tevye also unearths, invents, and imagines a much larger collective past at a time of crisis and rupture, forging the buried networks that turn strangers into cousins. In this sense, the 1963 Broadway production and the 1971 film Fiddler on the Roof also serve as a Jewish family tree, repository of a dream that doubles as a genealogical narrative that can bridge the geographic and cultural ruptures of the 20th century. I guess this is what I meant for that. Fiddler on the Roof also sheds light on the family resemblance between Jewish and other post-traditional cultures far beyond the pale of settlement. And I'll just summarize here that American identity is sometimes described as being a kind of citizenship of romance in which the notion of consent rather than descent. In other words, we're all children of immigrants, but we come here and we intermarry and we forget our differences in the romance that is America. So this romantic plot gets nationalized, according to some literary scholars, in the story of American citizenship. Fiddler on the Roof's most extravagant and memorable theater may not be the weddings that emblematize this romantic love, but Tevye's genealogical dream, which lodges a story of descent rather than consent at the secret heart of its praise of romantic choice. As Yiddish folklore and Hebrew autobiographers know, narrated lineages are never to be trusted, and family genealogists are as likely as matchmakers to be exaggerators, performers, scam artists, and keepers of unreliable records. In their work, memory and fiction, dream and theater, commerce and love can never be strictly distinguished. But the record hardly matters. If history is a collective dream, then our shared fascination with this story of an invented and inventive ancestor may be enough to constitute us as kin, even as it binds us as collective adherents to the modern religion of romantic love.
Thank you.
Thank you. To be celebrated with your extended family. Yes.
Seemed to be a theme here is that a lot of this was life following art. See? But then art also reflects life. Is this a sort of a dog chasing its tail thing?
Right. How to think about this? So how to think about the modern novel in terms of, you know, is it describing reality or is it provoking new forms of culture? I think it's, you know, obviously it's both. I mean, if people are naming their children after literary characters, then, and certainly the novel is in some ways, it's provoking a certain kind of cultural transformation. It's also the novel itself produces different ways of living. I mean, reading novels is part of a larger cultural shift. Which again is novel reading is, you know, replaces, it translates in a different way Jewish textuality, right? So you're reading novels, and one of the things that Pauline Vengeroff says that I didn't quote from that section is that when yeshiva boys started to read, actually they started to read poetry, German poetry, they basically took the ways in which they had read the Talmud, the sing-song, the shuckling, this, and the extreme attention to the words, right? So they would read a poem, and then they would read it collectively. They would go, what does the first thing mean? And they would go through it line by line, and they would argue about it, because Jews argue about the Talmud. So it's this, literature is a way of life, and it becomes Judaized through a certain kind of practice. So the ways in which literature and life were connected, there isn't a direct connection, right? So the first novel that they all fell in love with, they fell in love with because it wasn't about their own lives. There was also, I guess I'll just say one more thing about that, which is that there was also a problem because all these people who read Ahavat Zion, The Love of Zion, and decided they wanted to be novelists, were worried because they felt that they couldn't write novels because how do you write a novel if you're an Eastern European Jewish, usually man? You yourself were probably married at the age of 15. You never, I mean, the famous example that people describe is the autobiography of Mendel and Michael Sorum is called the grandfather of modern Hebrew and modern Yiddish literature. He said, I wanted to be a novelist, but I had never been to a ball. I'd never fought a duel. How do you write a novel if you've never fought a duel? You Google classes. He was, you know, there's a certain kind of irony here because obviously you write a different kind of novel. This is how he was talking about writing a novel that's about not being able to write a novel, about not really living a kind of romantic life, which is exactly the plot of what's considered the first European novel by many critics, right? Don Quixote. I want to be living in a chivalric romance, but I can't. I missed it. So for Jews, it was like, I want to be living in a modern novel, but I can't because I'm Jewish. So you write a novel about not being able to live in a novel. And this is what this is one of the contributions of Jewish literature, I think basically from Mendel and Mahasaram to Woody Allen. Woody Allen, if you look at a film like Love and Death, it's basically a romance that just completely makes fun of romance. So that gap between literature and life is actually part of literature. I guess it's part of life, too. And it's productive. It's a productive gap. Yes.
I have just a quick comment and then a question. I study Chinese literature, and I see many, many resonances between what I studied and what you talked about, including this interesting term you said in Hebrew for in-laws that actually does not have an equivalent in English. And in Chinese, we have a term, too, that has no exact equivalent in English, but it seemed to match the Hebrew word exactly. Huh. It means my children's spouse parents.
Right.
Anyhow.
And it's an important relationship.
Very important relationship. In fact, so I just taught a novel in a freshman seminar where there's this monster who marries himself into a family because he falls in love with the young girl, and the family complains. Then their main complaint is not because he's a monster, but because he's alone and he has no relation. They say, we have never met your relations. On holiday, we have nobody to do the comings and goings with. That's their complaint.
Why would we be happy for you to get married if we're not getting in-laws by it?
Exactly. So that's your point about marriage marriage as sort of this institution for creating extended family. That's just so much shared by Chinese literature as well. But anyhow, my question for you is that you mentioned that female hypergamy, or you know, women marrying up, is a feature of modern romance, not traditional marriage. To me, it seems that these women marrying up has always been a kind of a mechanism for upward social mobility in patriarchy. You know, if you're a peasant family, if you have a beautiful daughter, then maybe you have a chance, right, of getting her, you know, getting her to marry a rich man, into a rich man's family, or even become selected as the concubine of the emperor, right? And then you, of course, you finally made it. So why is that not part of the traditional marriage mechanism as well?
It's not at the core of how traditional Jewish marriage works. Maybe I should say one other thing about traditional Jewish marriage, which is that traditional Jewish marriage with matchmakers and with people marrying up is an elite practice. So among the poorer people, marriages are usually local, and you marry someone who's related and sexual. When there's no wealth trading hands, sure, being beautiful can't hurt. I mean, we'll get you up. It's a certain kind of standard way in which the elite accumulate status, which is status is a combination of wealth and Torah learning. And Torah learning is acquired through men, through young boys. It can also sometimes be acquired through the pedigree of a young woman. But at least in elite circles, if there is sexual attraction, and if there is a beautiful girl, it's considered rather gauche. You're not really supposed to talk about it in the same way you're not supposed to talk about, oh, I met this really great guy, and he's also rich, by the way. It's gauche. It's considered, sexual attraction is not considered a sufficient reason to consider, you know, the estimation of beauty is considered to be a kind of it's not an aspect of elite Jewish culture, which doesn't mean it didn't happen. It could well have happened without it being spoken. But to make it the primary way in which a marriage is arranged, it's not in the literature. It's only in the literature for the masses. The masses were lucky because they got to think about such things because they didn't have to worry about Torah studying or wealth. So in other words, the one place where it does come up, interestingly, is in intermarriage. A beautiful young woman, a beautiful Jewish woman, sort of like the Queen Esther. There are Polish myths about beautiful Jewish women who are found attractive by the ruling figures, and and the king will marry a beautiful Jewish woman. But you'll find it in folk songs, but not in the kind of elite practices I'm talking about. So this idea that a Jewish woman can marry up through her beauty is really a new thing when it happens to Tevye's oldest daughter. And it's so new, he doesn't understand what's going on. So when that conversation with Laser Wolf, where he thinks Laser Wolf is talking about his cow, that Laser Wolf wants to marry his cow, and Laser Wolf is actually talking about his daughter, it's what's being described as a culture in transformation where people don't understand each other because he doesn't know the language of, why would you want to marry my beautiful daughter? Like, he doesn't quite get, you might admire her, but like to actually bring her into your house, this is a new concept for him. So why it is that Jewish society doesn't have a similar availability of upward mobility for beautiful young women, and maybe it does. I mean, it's hard to believe that it doesn't. I mean, we're talking about human beings. But at least at the very least, you could say it's a much less well-discussed phenomenon. And whereas the examining the groom, it's everywhere in the literature. So I think Jews basically believe that overestimating female beauty was a Gentile thing to do.
Yeah. Can I ask you why you did not mention the Book of Ruth in your book?
Or the Song of Songs. Boy, I didn't mention a lot of things, but why the Book of Ruth?
Because that is a beautiful love story.
Between women?
No. The Book of Ruth, she's a Moabite woman. And she, Naomi, Boaz.
So between both, it's an interesting, it's the reason why I would like to say it's interesting for another reason. So I didn't get to say this, so maybe I'll say it now, which is that I have a sort of one sentence diagnosis of traditional Jewish culture that I came up with. And I feel like I'm talking too long, no? Just another minute or two. So the one sentence diagnosis is that traditional Jewish society has a bisexual distribution of sexual energy between a partially eroticized homosocial sphere and a partially de-eroticized heteronormative sphere. So let me say that again. A partially eroticized homosocial sphere is that there are all these ways in which men hang out together and women hang out together, and these are erotic, or at least partially erotic. So the yeshiva, the rabbinical court, the Hasidic court, in the case of Ruth and Naomi, the ways in which the big separation between men and women means that when women hang out together, when people hang out together with people of their own gender, then something erotic happens. That is combined with a partially de-eroticized heteronormative sphere. It's heteronormative, which means everyone has to get married, but it's de-eroticized in the sense that it's not done through sexual attraction. The matches are not contracted through erotic means the way they are in the modern love match, at least officially. Now, these spheres are connected because marriages are contracted through homosocial relations. Now, one of the things that's so interesting about the Book of Ruth is that the marriage between Boaz and Ruth is contracted through the matchmaking help of Naomi, my namesake. She arranges this marriage, which on the one hand seems so rebellious and natural and free, right? They're basically in the field somewhere. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, there's some older woman pulling the strings. And not only that, the baby that's born, is she considers it her baby. So this is actually a very good example of a hybrid between a romantic love story and one in which the larger family gets to play a role.
But Bruce was in love with him and wanted to lay with him. She made sure she could.
Right.
Even though they hadn't even announced it yet to their relatives that she was available.
So the Bible loves to have it both ways too. Maybe that's where the Jewish literature gets it. I'll give you another example. So both ways is the story of Jacob and Rachel is the grand love story, right? He works 7 years to marry her. And yet it has a kind of cynical, men and women are basically interchangeable, which is the ideology behind arranged marriage. You throw in any boy, any girl into a bedroom, and 9 months later you have a baby. He sleeps with her, he thinks he's in love with Rachel, and he is. And he sleeps with his sister, and he doesn't even know it. In the dark, all cats are alike. The Bible knows both of those truths. Both of those things are true. There's really only one person for you. And if you marry someone else, you know, maybe it's okay too. If anyone has
a question out there?
Yeah, I have a question. Well, yeah, well, you've already discussed this, but in the Bible, not in the Bible, but in the real world, the sexual agency plays a prominent role in marriages. Yet, in this Ashkenazi culture, it has been expunged from the ritual of marriage. So, It's a long time period between the Bible and Ashkenazi Polish culture. But how did it happen that sexual agency seemed to be removed from the...
Very good question. I mean, you could see why a biblical romance would be so appealing, because you're saying, this looks like a foreign practice, but look, Jews were doing this. Amazing love, you know, the Song of Songs, the Book of Ruth. How did it happen? It seems to have been a function of, it's not, you know, it seems to have developed in the post-Crusade era, and it seems to have had something to do with the rebuilding of Jewish communities. So the role of, at least one theorist that I read, says that the role of pedigree was a way to ensure that no one was marrying a close relative after families got dispersed. And then the rabbis became matchmakers in order to rebuild communities, in order to avoid inadvertent incest after the Crusades, and then attained a certain kind of powerful place in the society. How exactly that happened, I can't reconstruct it, but someone named Israel Abrahams, who published a book about this, who's a medieval historian. It's an old book, so I don't even know if scholars still use it. I somehow used a lot of old material in this book. It's an old-fashioned book.
On that, again, somewhat provocative note, let us thank our guests.
Thank you.